Hi everyone and welcome to the 8th seminar of the series of the Latin American webinars on physics. My name is Avelino Vicente, I'm from University of Liège in Belgium, and I will be your host today. So it's a pleasure for me to introduce Hernana Soley. She's from Laboratorio de Detección de Partículas y Radiación, Lab DPR, a lab that belongs to the Centro Atómico Bariloche and Instituto Balseiro in Argentina. He will talk about LAGO, an extended cosmic ray observatory in Latin America. Well, he received his PhD from Instituto Balseiro in Bariloche, Argentina, and after a postdoc in Universidad Industrial de Santander in Bucaramanga, Colombia, he moved back to Lab DPR, where he's currently a researcher working on astroparticle physics. Today, Hernán's talk will be entitled LAGO, Measuring Cosmic Rays in Latin America, and we are very glad to have him as our speaker today. I would like to remind you that we can be part of the discussion by writing questions, comments, using Google Plus Q&A system, and also with Twitter using hashtag. So, well, welcome everybody, and now Hernán, it is your turn.
Well, thank you very much for your presentation and for giving me the opportunity to be here with you. I will start to share my screen in order to share the presentation, and then I will come back for the questions, if you agree. Okay, so as they introduced me, my name is Hernán Soley, and I will talk about our Latin American project, which is called LAGO, which means Latin American Gigant Observatory. What we are doing here in Latin America is to measure cosmic rays with extreme precision and in different sites of Latin America. So the overview of this talk, we will start talking about the LAGO project, and then I will describe briefly the detectors that we use in LAGO, and then I will go through the different LAGO programs that we are carrying out here in Latin America, and then final conclusion and invitation to other people to share this opportunity and to join us in this project. As I mentioned before, the LAGO is an extended observatory which is located in eight countries in Latin America. We are including now a new detector in Brazil. It will be working by the end of this year. And the LAGO collaboration is a Latin American collaboration that includes more or less 70 members from 22 institutions from 9 Latin American countries. Recently, Spain is joining us in the LAGO collaboration. They are giving good support for the data analysis frameworks and the simulation frameworks in using the grid network in Europe. We have scientific goals and we have academic goals. Within our scientific goals are to measure astroparticles, the flux of astroparticles up to the cosmic rays Ni, and we study transient and long-term space weather phenomena, and we also measure with extreme detail the background radiation at ground level, where the detectors are located, and at the same level of importance, we have academic goals, and those are to train Latin American students. Here in Latin America, is not so easy to have access to different facilities in high energy or in astroparticle or even in astrophysics, in astrophysical techniques. So our main goal is to train Latin American students in these techniques and to form people in these fields, and also to build a Latin American network of astroparticle researchers. This is the current status of our LAGO network. You can see that we are mainly distributed over the Andes range, in the Cordillera de los Andes, and we work as a non-centralized and collaborative network of institutions. We have three working groups, and we have a coordination committee, which is formed by one member from each country, and the principal investigator, the coordinator, the general coordinator of the collaboration, and we share all the developments and all the expertise that we produce in some site with the other people in the network. So it is a highly collaborative network of institutions. We produce, for example, the electronics for the control and acquisition of data of our detectors. We produce this data in Bariloche here in Argentina and in Mexico, but now they are it is being produced in Colombia, and from Colombia we are developing new sites in the Andean range from Ecuador, Venezuela, and Peru and Bolivia. So we share all this expertise producing some site with people in some other sites. We start with the detector. The detector is very simple. It is a so-called water Cherenkov detector. We use this kind of detectors because it is very cheap, it is reliable, simple, and it is autonomous because of the electronics that we produce for this detection. The detector is based on a commercial tank, which different detection area, which is filled with purified water. It depends on the water that we have in each site. We produce different process to purify this water. Each detector is covered inside with an inner coating, which is a very high diffusive and reflective fabric, which is under the water. And the main purpose of this coating is to diffuse the Cherenkov light that each charged particle produces when it goes through the detector. This light, after the diffusion in the Tyvek, is collected by a PMT, which is typically an 8 or 9 inch PMT from Hamamatsu photonics or electronic tubes. And we use a digitizer board from 40 to 100 megahertz and 10 to 25 nanoseconds in the sample. The sampling ratio, and we also use an FPGA with a controlled by a Raspberry Pi computer to produce a detector control, the telemetry, and the data acquisition. All this equipment is synchronized in time by using the GPS, and with this mode we have more or less 10 nanoseconds of time differences between detectors located up to 1,000 kilometers in distance. The consumption of the station is more or less 10 watts. So another process that we are developing is the station that controls the detector. The idea here is that we have a station that controls the detector and also acquire atmospheric data that could be used for other experiments. For example, we are starting to measure the concentration of carbon dioxide in the sites where we are measuring the cosmic rays, because it is of very interest for people working in global warming processes, or the distribution of plants in these sites to know the temperature, the pressure, and also the concentration of greenhouse gases. So we use our station to acquire a lot of atmospheric data. Some of this data we use to correct our data, and some other is for other communities that could use this type of of data, and of course this can be used by any university independent of the water Cherenkov detector. It is not necessary to build a water Cherenkov detector to measure these environment variables, so we could perform some kind of environmental network of data supported in this kind of autonomous stations. About the LAGO programs, LAGO have four different programs, which we call the LAGO Extreme Universe, Space Weather, LAGO Virtual, and LAGO Universities. And each one of these programs have different scopes. As I mentioned before, all the people working in the collaboration is working in three different working groups. The working group number one is the physics, the number two is detectors, and number three is the data. And of course, all are very related, because the data analysis that are being developing has in extreme contact with the physics and also with the detectors. So this is mainly the organization of our working groups. So to enter into the details, we are a Latin American network, and since we are distributed along Latin America, we have to move the data from all of these different sites to the central repository, and that means that we have to share more or less 1 terabyte of data per year per detector. And for the simulations that characterize each site, we have to move 3 terabytes per year per site. And all of these we are using, where it is available, the Red Clara, which is an academic network of high bandwidth network that is present in more of the detectors, in more of the countries that are operating LAGO. And we use this kind of networks to share all the data and to move all the data to the central repository, which is located in Colombia. The LAGO was also selected by ChineReds, which is a project from the European Committee, and it was the first data repository in Latin America. And we are implementing in our data the so-called DART protocol, which means data access, that the data has to be accessible, has to be reproducible, and has to have some level of trustworthiness to warranty the quality of our data. And also, as I mentioned before, we are developing a Corsica version of the simulation codes that it is implemented on the grid, and it is available for all the people working in LAGO, and also for other people working in astroparticle physics that could want to use this implementation of Corsica simulations. So about the first physics program, this is the so-called LAGO Extreme Universe, and in this slide, I am showing three different extensive air showers. When a cosmic rays enter into the atmosphere, it produces a cascade of particles, which could have millions or billions of particles, depending on the energy. These particles are developing all the reactions across the atmosphere, and the particles, the final particles, reach into the ground, and those are the particles that we are measuring using our detectors. Of course, the type of primary, the type of cosmic rays, which we call the primaries, that enter into the atmosphere, will dominate the type of interactions that are producing into the atmosphere. And for instance, you can see here the different developments of a shower initiated by a gamma, or a proton, or an iron nucleus. They are very different because the interactions that are present are very different in type. Typically, the gamma showers are initiated by QED are dominated by QED reactions. Instead, protons and iron or nucleus interactions are dominated by QCD interactions. And at the level of the ground, you can see three different components in the distribution of particles, and you will find what we call the electromagnetic contents of the shower, which is mainly photons and electrons and positrons, and also the muonic component, which is formed by muons and by muons positive and negative, and all the other particles forms the hadronic component of the shower. But as this depends, the development of this shower depends also in the altitude, because the atmosphere acts as a shield to this kind of particles. So after the first interaction, and when the medium energy is below some critical values, the particles start to be absorbed by the atmosphere, so they disappear from the evolution of the cascade. So if you go up and up into the atmosphere, you could reach energies lower energy. Sorry, as an example, I am showing here the same electromagnetic shower initiated by a gamma of 500 TeV, and here you can see four other different showers initiated by gammas, but of lower energy, of course, from 1 GeV, 5 GeV, 20 GeV, and 100 GeV. And you can see that if you want to measure these very low energy showers, you have to go up and up into the atmosphere, because of the absorption of the atmosphere is very high. So, bearing this in mind, this was the original purpose of LAGO, was to detect gamma ray bursts in high altitude sites in Latin America, and by using this kind of simulations, we are deploying four detectors in Sierra Negra, which is in Mexico. These are four segmented 40 square meters water Cherenkov detectors, and the first one of it start to measure in August of 2014, and the other four detectors will operate beginning this year in 2015. We are deploying all the detectors that we have in Chacaltaya. We are changing the electronics in Chacaltaya, giving this new detector electronics to increase the sensitivity of the detectors in Chacaltaya. And we hope that in Venezuela, at Pico Espejo, the cableway will be operative in this year, and we could start the operation of our water channel core detectors in Pico Espejo. This is more or less 4,500 meters of altitude. And we are also doing the reanalysis of the full data set to use new detectors, new analysis techniques to look for GRB candidates. And we found two new candidates that will be presented in the ICRC, and also we are developing in Colombia the first steps in the development of an array of water channel core detectors that will be the first astroparticle array that had been located in the equatorial zone. So for the space weather is very important for us, because it is mainly dominated by what we call the Sun-Earth connection, in the sense that the dynamic conditions in the outer space of the Earth are modulated by the solar activity. This has importance not only at the physics or the basics, the basic research, but also for studies that has to be with the technologies like satellites or grids of electrical powers, or also for the corrosion in long pipelines all of these geomagnetic effects and heliospheric effects have influence over our daily life. So it is important for us to produce data that could be used to monitor and also to forecast the occurrence of this kind of
I think we are having a problem with the connection. Hernan, are you there? Okay, this is something that was somehow expected that could happen. So in the meantime, while Hernan comes back, let me say a few things. So first of all, you are invited to ask questions, to write comments, whatever you need. You can do it in Q&A section in Google Plus. That will be very welcome because we can ask questions afterwards. And of course, you can also use this method to suggest topics for future seminars. So feel free to do it. And let's see if Hernan comes back. Oh, he's not here. So. Hernan. Let me see if I can contact him somehow. He left. Let's wait a few minutes to see if he can reconnect. Hopefully he will be able. So, as I was saying, you can use this method of Q&A. Ah, okay, Hernan is back. So, I think.
Hello?
Hernan,
I think that
back.
We have a problem. Yes?
Okay, so I hand you over the talk, so you can continue.
Okay. Sorry, it was
no problem. No problem. Okay.
Okay. So the final idea is to correlate the variations of the signals at the detector level with the solar activity. To do that, you have to control all of these modulations, principally those related with the detector response and also with the atmospheric conditions that are the ones that you can measure directly in each side. So it is support in a complex chain of simulation, which are very detailed simulation chain. For to do this and to include the geomagnetic effects at different conditions, we use the DST, which is the disturbance storm index, to measure to know the status of the geomagnetic field, and we calculate in real time the directional rigidity cutoff at each one of our sites, and then we have a primary flux using measurements of this primary flux, and we do Corsica simulation for each site at each one of our sites. Now we are including, we are starting to develop a process to obtain the atmospheric profile at each site by using the Global Data Simulation System, which is provided by NOAA, and using the measured spectra for all nuclei from protons to iron, we try to reproduce the secondary particles at ground level, which are that the ones that will be measured by our detector. With these simulations, we obtain the secondary flux at detector level, which is modulated by the geomagnetic field and the atmospheric conditions. Then we have three different simulations for the detector response. We have a very simple code that we call LAGOFAST, which is based in more complicated simulations. Then we have a detailed simulation program based on SHAN-4, which is a typical code that you can find in particle physics. And now we are starting to use Fluca for these kind of simulations. As an example of the different flux depending of the altitude, you can find here the simulated flux at detector level for two of our sites. This is at the left of the screen. You can find the Bariloche, the flux expected at Bariloche, and in the right you can find the expected flux of secondaries and the distribution of momentum of these particles at Chacaltaya, which is in Bolivia at more than 5,000 meters above sea level. And you can find that in the total number of particles, we have almost an order of magnitude in the number of particles, and also the distribution is very different. You have more or less 20% of muons in the total content of particles at ground level for these simulations and the parameters of these simulations. And using the same parameters, you have 5% of muons at more than 5,240 meters of altitude. This is expected because at this altitude, the muons, the pions have no time to decay and produce, the charged pions produce charged muons, the muons, sorry. So in this kind of sense, we are doing different simulations at different sites, each people working in the working group one. The physics-related working group are producing different simulations. For example, you can see in the left upper panel one of the simulation of the geomagnetic effect at one of our sites in Colombia. This has been produced by students in Colombia. At the right, you can see the site characterization of one of the new sites in Colombia, which is located in Pasto, near the border with Ecuador. These are the first attempts of simulations of the people of Pasto. Then you can find in the lower panel the Fluca response that has been produced for the tank that it is located in Ecuador, in Quito. And for instance, in the lower right panel, you can find one of the simulations of the Chan-4 simulation for the response of the tank to the muons present in the particles. Then we can compare these kind of simulations with data coming from the detectors that are being simulated, and compare, for instance, the critical times of decay of the pulses to compare with the simulations and validate these simulations. So for the data analysis, we develop an automatic detection of histogram features. We produce a charge integrate. The charge of each pulse is integrate, and we do some kind of pulse shape discrimination of the pulses produced in each one of the detectors. And by using these charge histograms, which are related with the energy deposited in the detector by each type of particles, we produce this integration of the histogram by bands. And using these bands, we have the counter of the number of particles within this deposited energy that the particle deposit the energy inside the detector. And using this, we know that for example, the yellow band is dominated by the electromagnetic components of the shower, photons and electrons and positrons. The orange band is dominated by muons, and the red band is dominated by simultaneous particles going through the detector at the same time. So by using this, we could do some kind of analysis in different energy ranges for the particles and the modulation of the flux by looking at different energy ranges of deposited energy in our detector, which are related with different energies, with different primary energies. So by doing that, we can see here, for example, the what we call a Forbush event. This is the diminution of in the number of in the flux of particles at ground level, which correspond to the coronal mass ejection reaching the Earth and producing, in some cases, like in this one, a geomagnetic storm. So from ground level and using a single water Cherenkov detector, which has an area of less than 2 square meters, we are able to detect the occurrence of this kind of phenomena, which is extremely important for the forecast and for the understanding of solar space weather phenomena. And also by looking specifically at the muon band, we could have, for example, in this case, the variation of the muons particles at ground level. So by using this tank and with this type of analysis, we are able to reproduce data produced by other different detectors, such as the global neutron monitors. It is not the global muon monitor. It is not equivalent because since we are we could have some contamination from electromagnetic particles at the muon band, but the modulation that we observe is compatible with the modulation expected by the flux of muons, which correspond to this band. So in this case, and in the sense of the space weather, we are producing new sites that are mainly oriented to study these space weather phenomena. And since we measure mainly charged particles, primary charged particles, it is important for us to go to sites where the geomagnetic cutoff is the lower possible, and the Antarctica and also the Arctic zone has a very low geomagnetic cutoff. So we are starting to develop a site in the Antarctica. We are starting with the construction of a laboratory in one of the Argentinian bases that are located in the Antarctic Peninsula. This is the Marambio base, and you can see there the particular installation that we will use in the Antarctica. And also we can by putting one detector in one level and another detector in another level, and using, for example, the floor, the concrete floor in some building, we could emulate a muon counter by looking in coincidences between the upper tank and the lower tank. Because of the shielding produced by the tank and by the concrete floor, we are certainly sure that only those muons could go through all of this system. And so if we measure in coincidence, we are sure that we are measuring in the lower tank only the flux of muons. So other developments like the one that it is being built in Colombia at the Universidad Industrial Santander, or by CONIDA Peru in the Huancayo Geomagnetic Observatory, we are starting to develop small arrays of water Cherenkov detector. In this case, you can see here 3 water Cherenkov detectors in one array, a triangular shape array of 100 meters of size. And in this case, we can measure not only the individual flux at each one of these detectors, but also we could find correlation between the signals in the 3 different detectors to find the occurrence of showers of higher energy by using this kind of arrays. So by doing this kind of array of water Cherenkov detectors, we are starting to go to higher energy respect to have a single tank measuring only the flux of the background flux of secondary at ground level. So for the background, this is based on simulations, and you can see that the atmospheric reaction produces the background radiation that part of the background radiation that we are exposed in everyday life, and of course, since the atmosphere introduce a shielding effect on these astroparticles coming from outside of the Earth. You can see that as you go up and up, the number of particles has been increased up to the altitude of 4,000 or 14 kilometers. In this case, at the 14 kilometers, we reach the maximum number of particles. And in this case, you can see that at the commercial flights level of 11,000 meters of altitude, you have more or less 100, two order of magnitudes in the total flux of particles that you could expect respect to the sea level values. And other developments that we are conducting in some countries of the LAGO project is to start to build muography of volcanoes. This muography technique is quite similar to the radiography technique that has been used in everyday life, but in this case we use muons, which are very penetrating particles into the different type of matters, to use these muons as tracers of the density distributions inside volcanoes. By using this, you can find regions by measuring the flux of the directional flux of muons through different type of objects. You can measure the integrated density along this trajectory, and with this you can obtain the density profile inside of the volcano, and you can find different type of structures like the pipes or magmatic chambers of this kind of thing inside the detectors. As an example of this technique, I am showing here a volcano muography that is performed by a Japanese team of different type of volcanoes, and in this case you can find there the magmatic chamber and the pipe inside of this volcano, and this kind of studies that we are starting reproducing parallel to LAGO in different countries of the region in Latin America. We are starting here in Argentina. There is a project approved in Colombia, and many people from Ecuador and also from Peru are very interested in these kind of techniques that can use the technology that we developed for LAGO and other astroparticle experiments to measure this kind of volcanic phenomenon. This is our proposal for the telescope that we are starting to build. With the shown efforts from different countries in Latin America, that combines the usual technique used in this kind of volcano muography with a water Cherenkov detector tank, very similar to the ones that are developing for LAGO. So the final program that I will share with you is what we call the LAGO University, is that since we have detectors located in the universities, we have different experiments that can be conducted by students at different levels, and we use the data from our detectors to introduce different techniques of data analysis, or also from statistical analysis, or for different type of techniques at different levels in the development of the students in the physics career. For example, in the left column you can see the very first introductory physics course of the physics career in Colombia, that they did a similar analysis to this weather space phenomena. And also for the particle physicists in the right, you can see there the mu and decay experiment that can be done by using our detector, the data measured in our detector, by measure the time differences between pulses, because some of the muons that go into the tank didn't have enough energy to go through the tank and then decay inside the detector, producing a high energy electron that has enough energy to be detected also by the detector. So by looking at this kind of events, you can measure the muon decay time, the lifetime of the muons. So I'm using that. You can use in the different courses to look for instance, different physics phenomena or things like that. So, as a conclusion, we have an ultra-long baseline array of water Cherenkov detectors. Each one of these detectors can be considered as a node of our distributed extended cosmic rays observatory, which is located from the south of Mexico up to, in the near future, to the Antarctica. We have high and low altitude sites in the Andean range, and we measure with extreme detail the background radiation, and we use this background radiation to look for space weather phenomena and high energy phenomena. And we develop also in Latin America new smart water Cherenkov detectors that produce some of the analysis of the data on board of the same water Cherenkov detector, and we also put environmental stations that control the water Cherenkov acquisition and also that produce data that could be useful for other communities, and we develop a full simulation chain. But I think that the most important thing of LAGO is that we also produce local and regional integration of universities and citizen science initiative. And we are a very active community. For example, in this next ICRC, we will present 10 different presentations for the things that we are doing in Latin America. And we have funding from different countries at different Latin America countries. And also we are, instead of have a single and high fund, we produce small projects to be funded by different, according to the possibilities of the different Latin American countries. So this is also an invitation for all of you to stay tuned with us and to join to our effort to develop high energy and astroparticle physics in Latin America. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Hernan. Very nice talk and a very interesting project, so congratulations. Now it's time for questions. So first of all, I would like to give time for people participating in the Hangouts. So if any of you want to participate, now is the moment. No? Okay, maybe we can move to...
Yeah, we have a question here from...
Roberto, please go ahead.
So, I mean, I wrote the question in the Q&A, but anyway, I'm better to ask it in live. So one of the first questions is, how much is the cost of each of these detectors?
Well, the detectors are cheap and are cheaper compared with other particle detectors. Depending of the local costumes and the local taxes, the expensive part is, of course, the photomultiplier tube, which is about $2,500. But this is the price in the United States, and you have to import to Latin American, and it could reach up to $4,000 or even $5,000 for the PMT. And then you need only $1,000 extra to the other parts of the detector. So with up to $5,000 or even $6,000, you could have one of these detectors working in not more than 1 week. So it is very cheap and it is very fast to be constructed, the detector. We have also to provide LAGO is providing to the new institutions the acquisition electronics, not the FPGA, which are or the Raspberry Pi, which are very cheap and also are accessible in almost all the world. But the electronics, the acquisition electronics that we develop is provided by LAGO to the new institutions that are showing.
And just a small stuff. And the maintenance of the detector is, I guess, it's very cheap. I mean, it's like you mount it and you get there, no?
Well, the idea is that once you start to measure, you don't have to touch your detector anymore. So in the ideal, we have some detectors that we didn't touch in more than 4 years. So the maintenance is mainly oriented to keep the data flowing. So it is usually a problem of the network more than a maintenance of the detector. Once the detector is built and is calibrated and start the normal operation, the idea is that you have not to touch the detector anymore. This is the ideal case.
Okay, thank you. Also, we have another question from Dimitrios here in FIC.
Hello, and thank you for the nice talk. My question is not related just to the physics, but for the course you mentioned, are there any notes or is there anything available?
Sorry, I didn't hear the first part of the question. Could you repeat it?
If there is a kind of website or telematic slides or something like that in which he could check for the courses.
Ah, okay. Yes, we have a lagoproject.org is our site, and we develop a course, for example, to calculate the flux using simulations at each one of these of our sites. We is a technique that we develop for LAGO, and it is available. It is available in YouTube, and the slides are in the page. You can find that in the lagoproject.org website. And sorry, Roberto. And also we did 3 schools in Latin American for LAGO oriented schools. The last one was in Quito, and the slides and the topics of the school are available in the web. I don't remember now if you have a link in our site, but we could put a link in our website.
Thank you.
I have a question also more related with organization. I see that there is no Chilean institution participating in the project, and I don't know what are the minimal requirements for an institution to be part of LAGO.
Well, you don't have a strong requirement to be part of LAGO. The only thing that we are asking now is to have to present the project. We have different projects that can be presented in different sites, and if you got the money to build the detector, mainly you can start to join LAGO. Why there is no Chilean institution from Chile? It's something that I don't know, but we are, of course, open to the incorporation of new institutions in Latin America that could be very good for us to have as much as sites as possible. So the only requirement is that you should need to get the funding to build the detector, which is mainly the principal obstacle is to have the money to build to buy the photomultiplier tube, which is not so much money. I mean, this
in total, well, you already talk about that, but in total, how much money for one of these could be.
In total, and in total, and if there is no problem with the customs or no problem with the taxes, you should expect to spend more or less $5,000 for the complete. I mean, the FPGA cost more or less $150. The Raspberry Pi is $50. The electronics, we put the electronics, the acquisition electronics. Perhaps you could buy the components, which are not more than $200. So the tank is a commercial tank. It is $500. It is very cheap. The only thing that is relatively expensive is the PMT, which costs, as I mentioned before, $2,500 more or less in the United States. Then you have to import to your country.
And well, one last question, and it's about the places to locate mm-hmm. those instruments. There is a minimum altitude or something like that?
No. It depends on the physics that you want to do. If you want to go to the to study extreme energy phenomena, you have to go more than 4,000 and 500 meters, more or less, depending on the site. But if you want to do space weather phenomena, there is no request for altitude. The ideal altitude is more than 500 meters and less than 2,500 meters to have a good development of the muons, but you can go up to the sea level without any problems to do space weather phenomena or other type of background radiation. Actually, for example, what we are doing in Pasto, in Colombia, is to start building a detector in the university, which is more easier than in the mountains. And then once you got some experience in the construction and in the operation of the detector, then you can go and to deploy a detector in high altitude sites.
Thank you for your answers. So we have some more questions from Roberto Lineros. Roberto, you want to ask those questions?
Yeah. Another question is about how well is LAGO 2 about cosmic ray discrimination? I mean, how well it can manage the different from gamma rays? Since it's just one tank, kind of, I don't know if you can.
Well, our last study to discriminate this kind of phenomena of GRVs from the background shows that only the very high energy component you can measure you are able to measure GRV, but those GRV which has at least 20 GeV of energy for our higher altitude sites. You can discriminate only by looking by what we call we have Bly analysis by looking to the excesses on 5 milliseconds range. I mean, perhaps these questions requires a bit more of explanation. Let me explain. When you have a proton shower, or you have an iron shower, or you have a gamma shower, the duration of this shower is very short. What we do in Chacaltaya is not to look for a single shower, but we look for excesses in the background flux at the level of 5 milliseconds. So 5 milliseconds for a single shower is a century, but you have several photons coming from the GRB that produce several showers, and these several showers will produce an enhancement in the flux of particles at ground level. So this is our technique. We didn't measure photon by photon or shower by shower, but we measure, we look for excesses in the background flux at the level of 5 milliseconds, and this is the blind analysis. The other analysis, which is the trigger analysis, which is we every time Fermi produce Fermi or Swift or whatever whatever probe produce an alert in the network of GRBs, we look at our data triggered by this alert. So we have two different analysis methods.
Okay, thank you. And I have two more questions, and then for me, One is very specific, like in the sense of if LIGO also seems to measure the solar activities, usually people use the neutron monitors. So is it possible that LIGO also uses the same technique, complementary technique, or there is something more? I mean,
well,
it's not contemplated to have a neutron monitor next to the detector.
Well, we have a different, the neutron monitor are a really spectacular technique to measure space weather and have been used for the last, I don't know, 40, 50 years to measure this kind of phenomena. The difference, we could emulate the type of signals that have the neutron monitors in order that they measure the flux of secondary neutrons at ground level. They specifically look for neutrons. We measure, but those neutrons are originated in the cascades, the extensive air showers produced by the interaction of a particle in the atmosphere. So in some sense, we do the same, but not looking only for the neutrons, which are very sensitive for this kind of measure, but we look to all the particles present in the all the charged particles present in the detector, in the shower. Sorry, and photons. We have some probability to get a pair creation inside the detector from a photon with more than 1.5 mega electron volt. So in this kind, you can measure with some probability, depending on the energy of the photon, photons by pair creation inside the detector. So we could reproduce, and I don't present it here, but we published some papers and proceedings showing the comparison between our data and data from neutron monitors. But there is also a difference, and this is this. A band analysis, because neutron monitor is a counting rate, and by using this pulse shape discrimination technique, we can measure a different bands of energy, and those are related with different type of particles. So we could have some kind of the evolution of background radiation at different energy ranges, at different energy levels. You can have the distribution of particles at ground at different energy ranges. And this is a difference with the neutron monitor.
Okay, thank you. And the last one, and that is
yes.
For me, I mean, it's a very naive question. Since the flux of particles that you can measure at altitude of commercial flight is so high, they were not planned to have a synergy with flights and have some very small size detector.
Well, of course you can go with a water Cherenkov tank inside an airplane, because it is more or less 1 ton. So it should be very expensive to carry these kind of detectors. But of course, we are, for example, in Auger, we are, more of the people in LIGO is also working in Auger, and the upgrade of Auger is based, the approved upgrade of Auger is based in scintillators, plastic scintillator strips. So we are doing here in Bariloche a detector that use this kind of technology to measure the flux, so that it is available to carry on board the plane.
Thank you. Yeah, for that reason I said that it was a very naive question.
There is another question in the chat. I don't know if you are looking. It is related with the sensitivity to horizontal neutrinos.
Yeah, this is a question from Mauricio. So Mauricio Bustamante, if you want, you can ask the question yourself.
Sure. Hi.
Hi.
Yeah. Okay. Yes. Okay. So my question was, just as Piroge can see new towns that come from the horizon or close to the horizon because of the large atmospheric path length, can the LIGO project do that, or will be able to do that at some point?
The answer is no, because to measure a neutrino, you need a large collected area, which is like the Auger array. The horizontal neutrinos produce a footprint of particles at ground that are touching different detectors. So you need a huge array of water Cherenkov or detectors, particle detectors, to could measure an horizontal neutrino. And also, Auger is located with the Andean range in the west part of the detector, at the west of the detector, sorry. So we can measure the neutrino produced also by the interaction of particles with the mountains that came as a down neutrino from the mountains, and you can measure that in the array. You need a huge array. You can't do that with a single tank. Okay, it was clear my answer.
Thanks. Can I ask a follow-up question to that?
Sure, of course.
Seeing as you would need something bigger, are there any plans to build like medium-sized or large detector arrays at any of the LIGO sites?
Yes, we are in the research and development phase, which to build 150 water Cherenkov detectors covering an area of 16 square kilometers in one of the Andean páramos in Colombia. This is the bigger array that we are planning at this point. I think that the equatorial zone is very interesting because you can see both of the hemisphere at the same time, and I don't know why it has been explored in the past, but this is what we are doing. This is a project that we start we are in the first steps, and actually these three small detectors working in a single triangular shape that we are building in Colombia is some kind of the research and development phase for this huge detector, because the major problem that we are facing, besides the money, which is also always is a problem, but the main problem is related with the amount of data that our detectors produce. So since you have more than 100 detectors, to move all this data by wireless link, it's not so easy. So we are developing techniques based on the standard protocols to could share the detectors, and that can be used in the future for other technical applications, not only for research and development basis.
Okay, thanks. And maybe I should ask my last question, then move on to Joel. So for theorists like myself working either from Latin American institutions or from abroad, are there any possibilities of contributing to LIGO?
Yes, we need that. We need contribution from other sites and other people. And even, for example, like the incorporation of these of people from Spain, they didn't plan to build a detector, but they are helping us with the development of, for example, infrastructure to our simulations techniques. So of course that we will be very glad to have help from other theoreticians or experimental physicists along the world.
Yep. Thanks.
Thank you, Hernan. So I think now we have a question from Lima. Joel Jones Perez, you want to ask a question?
All right. Can you hear me?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. Fantastic. So it's a quick question. I was just wondering, what are the main synergies, with other experiments? Like, what piece of information from some other experiment will be useful for you, and what sort of information can you provide to other experiments?
Well, do you hear me?
Okay. Yes.
We use data from different experiments in order to calculate, for example, the many people measure the flux of primaries at the top of the atmosphere, and this is what we use to perform our simulations. The simulation, which is something that is not directly related with LIGO, but we use the simulation technique, and the high energy interaction models that our simulations use comes from people of the LHC that measure with very good detail and high quality the cross section of the different reactions that go through the development of the cascade. So astroparticle techniques and astroparticle physics is some kind of joint effort from people of astrophysics and cosmology and from particle physics. So we directly or indirectly use a lot of data from different experiments. For the related with LIGO, we use, as I mentioned, data from Fermi or data from SWIFT or from other boards that measure GRBs as a trigger for our analysis, and also to improve the simulations by using, for example, the expected flux of photons or the spectrum of photons present in during a GRB, or also we compare our data with data from the neutron monitor for the space weather to look at differences there. And from the data that we could produce or we could give to other communities, beyond the data that we directly produce, as I mentioned, the atmospheric or environmental data, we could give information about the high energy component of the GRBs, or we could measure with extreme detail the background radiation at ground level, which could be important for people working, I don't know, in space weather, as I mentioned before, or even in the interaction of matter of radiation with matter. Our data, when we have this data flowing in real time, it will be used also for forecasting of the space weather phenomena. So I think that we could have a big impact in this kind of physics areas. Also, and let me finish this question. Also, the distribution of our detectors is longitudinal and non-latitudinal. I mean, we are more or less in the same longitude, and we are developing across a latitude in the Earth. So we are all the detectors are measuring the sky more or less at the same time. So now we are looking in our data. We are starting to look for repetitive sources by using the epoch analysis in our data. So I think that we could give this kind of, data to other analysis. And also our one of our objectives is to share all the data once it is finished the analysis. So we will put a, real-time monitor of background radiation at each one of our sites, and that could be downloaded from our site. This is our one of our objectives for this year and the next year.
Fantastic. Many thanks.
You're welcome.
Okay.
I have another question. It's related to CTA. I don't know if LAGO will, I don't know if it can provide some information that can be useful for CTA in case it can to South America.
Well, CTA is gamma astronomy. It's mainly gamma astronomy, and they did measure a photon in a photon by photon basis or in a particle by particle basis. So of course the environmental data that LAGO is producing and also the background rate data LAGO is producing could be useful for some other astroparticle experiments, but I don't know if CTA. For example, the rate of the background rate of particles at ground level could be useful, for example, for CTA. But this is a very local measurement, so it will depend on where CTA will be located in the future to know if we could improve the sensitivity. Also, what we are an idea that some of we had some time ago is to combine the measurements from CTA by putting some kind of water Cherenkov detectors in the at the CTA site. But I don't know. This is something that we will evaluate in the future with people from CTA.
Okay. Are there other questions? No, I don't see any. Okay. Then I think it's time to thank Hernan again for a very nice and informative presentation. Thank you, Hernan.
Well, I would like to, thank you to the organizers of these Latin American webinars, seminars. I think that we are doing a lot of things here in Latin America, not LAGO, all the Latin American people and Latin American physicists, and, this is a, an excellent opportunity to, share this with all the community. So thank you, for this effort. And I know that, produce these kind of things is difficult, so, thank you very much for the organization of this webinars.
Thank you, thank you. Well, actually, you did the, hardest job, so you, gave the talk. So. Thank you for, joining us, and well, thank you everyone. Thank you for watching, and we hope to meet you again in whenever we have the next webinar, Latin American Webinars on Physics. Thank you. Bye.
Bye.